bring down some, I pull down strongholds and cast down vain imagination and every high thing. You look God, the mansion destroys every yoke in my life, and my soul, spirit, and body, not functioning or according to divine systems of protocol. I decree and declare to heal and spirit fill sickness and relief. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. On my life. Good morning. Hey, D. Hey, DeShannon. Hey, Andrea. Good morning. How y'all doing this morning? YouTube lighting. Good morning. Good morning. Welcome. 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 See y'all coming in. Only do it. Yes. Trust them at all times. Good morning, Halo Ray. Good morning, y'all. Welcome. Welcome. Hey Tiff, good morning. Hey Nicole. Swear. Good morning, welcome. See y'all coming in. Hope you got your coffee, your journal, your Bible. He said you would. He did say he would do it. Good morning. Hey, love bug. Happy Thursday. Good morning. So amazing. Man, Tiffany, don't start none. Have me in here running, shouting, doing all kinds of stuff. Hey, Vanessa, I see y'all coming in. Welcome, welcome, welcome. I'm telling you, don't start none. Yeah, I'm telling y'all, if y'all haven't listened to this album, y'all need to get this album. Like, it's anointed. Like, there are some albums that are just anointed to get you through circumstances and situations. Good morning, good morning, welcome. Good morning, welcome. Welcome to Coffee and Conversations with LaKisha. I'm so excited to see you this morning. So excited about the word from God this morning and all he's just going to do to us. I'm listening to Grant Hawthorne's Won't He Do It? And I love one of the lines she says in here is, you're going to look back and be so amazed. He's going to look back and be so amazed. He'll do it. He just needs to you to trust in him and for you to live by faith. And if you haven't realized that we're seeing this in this story with Ruth, then I don't know what to tell you. This is the ultimate redemption story. This is a great example of what our relationship looks like in Christ and how it looks like in Christ and how Christ just longs to redeem and to restore us. So welcome to Coffee and Conversations with LaKisha. We are YouTube Live, Facebook Live, and Instagram Live. Do me a favor, go share the video, put the video in someone's hands. We're gonna be talking about redemption this morning, but also cautioning you a little bit about what you say with your mouth. You are going to harvest exactly what your mouth says. I mean, you're going to harvest it. I'm telling you, you're going to harvest exactly what your mouth says. So what is your mouth saying about your current situation? Let's go ahead and pray and get started. Father, we thank you. We thank you for this day. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for your mercy. We thank you for your love. We thank you for your peace. We thank you for your joy. We thank you, Father, for a fresh anointing this morning, one that destroys the yokes of bondage, of sickness, and disease. Lord, we thank you for renewing our minds in your word, Lord God, so that we could overcome and walk in the fullness of who you called us to be. Bless the people today, Lord God. Let the word not fall on deaf ears. Let it be implanted in their hearts, Lord, so that they can go multiply for your kingdom alone. And let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart, meditation of my heart be accepted in your sight. You are my strength. You are my redeemer. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, Holy Spirit, go do what only you can do. That's all I keep hearing in my spirit this morning, is that your mind be renewed, that your mind be renewed, that the whole purpose of everything that we've been experiencing and going through this morning is so that your mind can be renewed. Like, that's how you walk in faith. That's how you grow, is the renewing of your mind. And we know that that is scriptural. Yesterday I was working on a few things for promotions and flyers, and my photographer was here, and he was saying to me, he said, the only way that we overcome or get out of certain situations is that we renew our mind. He said, because so much of our life and thought process has been rooted to everything we've been tied to. And I was thinking about what he was saying, and he's so true. A lot of what you do is connected to so much you have been tied to. There are things that you do or participate in that you don't even realize you do. You do it almost unconsciously. And so the only way you may even be awakened to bad behavior or things that you have going on with yourself is the fact that your mind becomes renewed. The more you renew your mind, the more your spirit man will get a check, and you'll be like, wait a minute. Why did I believe that? Why did I trust that? Why was I acting like that? Man, a lot of you don't even realize how you don't operate in your authentic self, or how God uniquely, and what God uniquely created you for, because you've just been going to church for so long. You've just been doing religion for so long. You've just been doing God for so long that you didn't understand your unique divine appointment and how God created you. So the thing that's been happening with us is God has been renewing our mind so that we can walk in the fullness of what and who God called us to be. The fullness of what and who God called us to be. That's good, Connie. So this morning, if you've still been struggling with some things, ask the Lord, Lord, renew my mind. Show me myself. Let me see myself. Let me see who and what you call me to be. I only want to be my authentic self. I don't want to be anything else. I don't want to be anything someone thought I should be. I don't want to be anything else. I only want to be my authentic self. And that starts with renewing your mind. That's how you're going to be transformed. That's why I read so much. I read. I was laughing at myself the other day because I always tell people I'm really a nerd girl. And I was reading. I read this summer. I've read about 11 books from June 15th until now. I don't even know. That didn't even count at the beginning of the year. That's from June 15th to now. I've already read 11 books, and they've been books that encourage me and strengthen everything, my mind and my spirit. So then I'm understanding my clear identity of who I am in Christ. I was reading something this morning in Romans, and a revelation of something that I had never seen before came, and I was like, oh my gosh, this is major. We've been putting way too much responsibility on ourselves and so many different things. So let's get started. That was good though this morning. So renewing your mind. I love when the Holy Ghost takes things over. So we've been reading in the book of Ruth, and we're in chapter 2. And here we are seeing that Ruth has just had this encounter with Boaz. Boaz has set her up for redemption. He's recognized her. He's recognized her character. He's set her in a position and said, hey, you don't have to go anywhere else. May the Lord God bless you for all your efforts and everything you put in place. May the Lord God be with you for your efforts and everything you put in place. He's blessed her, and he's asserted herself. And I told you yesterday, there is a place of provision for you. So you have to understand what your place of provision is for you. So I want to go back and say, this is to the 15, 2 and 15. It says, when Ruth went back to work again, Boaz ordered his young men, let her gather grain right among the sheaves. See, she went from gleaming at the back and just picking up like the stalks and other stuff to Boaz said, nah, let her gather grain right among the man. That right there will make me shout. Let her gather grain right among the sheaves without stopping her, and pull out some heads of barley from the bundles and drop them on purpose for her. Drop them on purpose for her. You cannot tell me about God. God is purposeful with you. God is purposeful with you. If you didn't understand how purposeful God is with you, it has nothing to do with the things that you've done. Ruth is a Moabite. She would not even be worthy of what she's receiving. But because she made a vow, she took a stance, she made a decision, right, to serve God, to follow Naomi, God is doing something specific for her. There's a redemption going on, baby. There's a restoration happening here. And it says, and pull out some heads of barley from the bundles and drop them on purpose for her. Let her pick them up and don't give her a hard time. He set an edict out for her. He set some protection out for her. It says, so Ruth gathered barley there all day. And when she beat out the grain that evening, it filled an entire basket. She carried it back into town and showed it to her mother-in-law. Ruth also gave her the roasted grain that was left over from her meal. Man, she's ate with Boaz. Man, this is a blessing. It says, where did you gather all this grain today? Naomi asked. Where did you work? May the Lord bless the one who helped you. So Ruth told her mother-in-law about the man in whose field she worked. She said, the man I worked with today is named Boaz. And Naomi says, may the Lord bless him. He is showing his kindness to us as well as to your dead husband. This man is one of your closest relatives, one of our family redeemers. And I'm going to stop right there because something significant happens here. Naomi, when she came back into town, I'm going to skip back over to the first. She was destitute. She was desperate. She was upset. And she had a right. Her husband had died. Her sons had died. And when she first came in town, some women had came to a revival, and this is the 20 verse. And they were like, hey, no, Naomi, is it really you? And she says, oh, don't call me Naomi. She responded and said, call me Mara, for the Almighty has made life very bitter for me. I went away full, but the Lord has brought me home empty. Why call me Naomi when the Lord has called me to suffer? So Naomi saw this circumstance and this situation very different from Ruth. And this morning when I was meditating, the Lord showed me the differences. He said, LaKisha, look at the differences between Naomi's attitude and Ruth's attitude. Look at the differences between the two. Instead of Ruth being downtrodden, complaining, murmuring, talking about all the things that she didn't have, Ruth's mind and agenda was set on what she did have. And so I'm going to ask you to this morning, the question that you need to ask yourself is, what am I saying about my current situation? What am I saying about my current situation? What am I speaking about my current situation? If my kids are jacked up right now, if my marriage is jacked up right now, if my resources are a little bit short, what am I saying about my current situation? Proverbs 18 and 21 says, the tongue has the power of life and death, and those who love it will eat the fruit of it. See, Naomi was so fixated on what she didn't have. She was missing what God was doing and how he was blessing her and what she did have. She was so destitute, she didn't even realize what she was set up for. So I'm asking you this morning, ask yourself personally, what have I said about my situation? Am I so focused on my lack? Am I so focused on what I didn't have? Or am I going to be focused on what I do have? I know I shared with you guys that my husband died 4 years ago, and I was talking to my sons. My little boys want me to get married so bad. They're so funny. And I told them one day, I said, it'll happen when God designs for it to happen. But what we gonna focus on is the time that we did have with that. And what we're gonna focus on is how to love and enjoy each other, our small family. And as soon as they begin to change their focus to what they did have instead of what they didn't have, it changed everything around them. So the tongue has power of life. What are you saying about your current situation? Are you like Naomi? Oh, don't call me Naomi. Call me Mara. Or are you like Ruth? Ruth was talking to Boaz. She's at his feet. She's thanking them. She's saying, what have I done to do this kindness? She's blessing you, right? She's blessing God. She's blessing Boaz. She's just determined, you know what? I'm not going to allow this current situation to determine how I respond to God. And so often when we have things shift in our circumstance, our situation, we allow our current situation to determine our response to God or determine our response to what's around us. You're going to harvest whatever you say. I think God just had a setup for Naomi. I think Ruth, right, was Naomi's covering. I think because Ruth didn't partner with what Naomi was saying, that the Lord worked on their behalf. God saw what Ruth was doing and was like, I'm just going to ignore Naomi and what she's saying altogether, and I'm going to focus on what Ruth says. So whatever you're going through, check your mouth, check your circumstance. You're going to harvest what you say. It's so many scriptures. If you go over to Matthew, it's so many. It says, by your words, you will be acquitted, and by your words, you will be condemned. If you've released words over your current situation or even your past situation, those words have been released in the atmosphere. I'm going to encourage you now to repent. I'm going to encourage you now to repent. Lord, repent. Let me repent for every negative and every idle word that has ever come out of my mouth. I repent. I'm sorry. I'm sorry for getting my focus off you, and get your butt right back on track so that you can receive the harvest of good words and not bad words. My second thing that the Lord showed me in here was, regardless of what has happened, God still and will move on your behalf. Even if you messed something up, God still, he even blesses our mistakes to prosper. Even if Elimelech had went into Moab and he wasn't supposed to, we're seeing God still, the mistakes of him turn into a good thing. Romans 8 and 28, I'm telling you, says all things. Here's the thing, you need to read it in the NIV version. It actually says, God works for all of them that love him. God works for all of them that love him, who are called according to his purpose. If you're still right here at this point in your life, God is working because you were called to the greater purpose, and the responsibility really isn't on you like you think it is. Ruth 2 and 20 shows us Ruth's restoration. It says, may the Lord bless him. Naomi, he is showing kindness to us as well. It's showing Ruth's redemption in this. Today, I want you to do me a favor. Read it in either the New Living Translation version or read it in the NIV version. Go read Romans 8 today. Ask the Holy Spirit, show me what Romans 8. I promise you, some of the harsh responsibility that you've been putting on yourself, some of the things you need to understand, the power and the resurrection of who Christ is in your life. A lot of times we don't receive his grace because we don't understand it, and we think it's about our works, but it's about our relationship with him. Christ has already done some of the things that you've been working to do. He's just waiting on you to receive it. So regardless of what happened, God can still and will move all things according to his purpose, right? All things according to his purpose. And then the last thing I want to share with you is, make sure God, you're not hindering God. Don't hinder your reset. That's what the Lord told me. Don't hinder your reset. If God is trying to do a new thing in a new season, don't hinder your reset by still looking at old things. Don't hinder your reset trying to do something amazing for you. God may be trying to do something amazing for you, but because you're so focused on all the things that have happened in the past, you're missing this opportunity for God to reset you. He may be doing some things around you, but you such caught up into what you don't have, you're missing this reset. You don't even know how to receive how God is blessing or about to bless you. So ask the Holy Spirit, give me the eyes for what's working around me. Let me be able to see you, Lord, every day in my life. That's something I pray. Let me see your glory in my life. Let me see the Holy Spirit working in my life. Let me see you moving. And if you ask God to do that, he will. So what are you saying about your current situation? What are you saying about your current situation? Two, regardless of what has happened in your life, God can and still move all things. Yes, Vanessa, all things have come new. All things according to your purpose. Go read Romans 8, the full chapter of Romans 8, and ask the Holy Spirit to speak to you and show you how Romans 8 applies to your life. Do it in the New Living Translation or the NIV version, and then make sure you're not hindering this reset by focusing on the past. It was a setup. It was a setup for Naomi. She was so focused on what she didn't have, she was missing what the Lord was doing. If you're focused on what you don't have, you won't even be an expectation for what God is trying to do for you. So the new things may be coming in and you won't even be able to see them because you're still looking at your lack when you should be looking at the promise and what God has said. God's promises are yes and amen. And I promise you, he will not. I want to read this to you and then we're going to get out of here. God's not going to tell you he's going to do something. He's not. This is Isaiah 61. And God was talking to the Israelites about in their oppression and how he was going to restore them. And this is the second verse. It says, he has sent me to tell those who mourn that the time of the Lord's favor. I feel like that to the time of the Lord's favor has come. The time of the Lord's favor has come. And with it, the day of God's anger against their enemies. To all who mourn in Israel, he will give you a crown of beauty for ashes, a joyous blessing instead of mourning, festive praise instead of despair. In their righteousness, they will be like great oaks that the Lord has planted for his own glory. Do you know what I do when I read stuff like this? I put my name in here. They will rebuild. I said he will rebuild LaKisha in the ancient ruins, repairing LaKisha's cities destroyed long ago. LaKisha will be revived, though they have been deserted for many generations. Foreigners will be your servants. They will feed your flocks and plow your fields and tend your vineyards. You will be called priests of the Lord, ministers of our God. You will feed on the treasures of the nations and boast in their riches. Instead of shame and dishonor, you will receive a double share of honor. You will possess a double portion of prosperity in your land, and everlasting joy will be yours. For I, the Lord, loves justice. I hate robbery and wrongdoing. I will faithfully reward my people for their suffering and make an everlasting covenant with them. When God, Philippians 1 and 6 says, when God has started or began a good work in you, he's going to complete it. If God begins a good work in you, he's gonna complete it. Your pain, whatever happened, your divorce, whatever occurred, me being a widow, my husband dying, that wasn't the end of my story. That wasn't the end of my story. As a matter of fact, it just set me up for redemption. It just set me up for redemption. That wasn't the end of my story. Well, we're out of time. Remember, I told you this week, our focus was on praying for families. And so we prayed. I posted a confession for wives. I posted a confession for husbands. Today, I'm going to post a confession that you can confess over your children. These are things that you could say that are contrary to even the situation. But even if your children are doing well, you can still speak these things. You can release good words in the atmosphere for your children. It says, God's mercy hovers over my child. The covenant I have with God in the blood of Jesus extends to my children and even my grandsons, covering them completely. Everything God gives to me, he'll give to my children, including peace and protection. I lay hold of God's plans and promises for my children by faith, and I call those things of change to come to pass in their life. I believe God for my child's deliverance and salvation. I put all my trust in the Lord concerning my children and even for me, my grandsons. And I am filled with joy because I know they are turning to the Lord. No matter how far away my child seems to be, there is no place where God can't reach them. I'm not moved by what I see, but by what the word says. I believe that Christ will capture their heart and they will follow them and obey them. That's something I confess over my kids every day. And I call their names out. I call their names out. I call all five sons, my sons' names out, and all four of my grandsons' names out. And I remind the Lord that the covenant that he has extended to me is the same covenant that is there for my children and my grandchildren. And even if something doesn't line up, even if it looks like one of them are doing something they have absolutely no business, the promises of God are yes and amen. And I hold steadfast to this. I hold steadfast to their return. I hold steadfast to everything that God is saying to me. I hold steadfast and I won't believe anything else. I don't care how intense it gets. No, Lord, these are my children. This is my covenant. This is my seed, and I'm not backing down. They're going to walk in good health. They're going to fulfill their purpose. For my sons that are not married, you're preparing a wife for them. For my son that's married, his marriage will be whole and be a glory to the kingdom. For my grandsons, they will reach every developmental milestone, because they're all under 4 years old. They will do well. For my son's still in school, that they'll be able to retain everything that they need to retain in school, that they'll have the favor of God upon them everywhere that they go, that they operate in integrity and character. Those are the things that I speak and say over my sons and release into the atmosphere daily. And sometimes it doesn't look like it's working, but I'm telling you, it's working. God hears, adheres, the angels hear and adhere to the words that come out of our mouth. Proverbs 8:2, the tongue has the power of life and death, and those who love it will eat the fruit of it. That's good or bad. That's good or bad. So today's confession is over your children. I love you. If you have any prayer requests, please drop your prayer request below, or email us at contactus@lakishamjohnson.com. Go subscribe to the YouTube channel, Coffee and Conversations with LaKisha. Also, link in with us on Facebook, LaKisha M. Johnson. You can follow me anywhere on social media at justbeinglmj. Don't forget this Saturday's dedication to sickle cell anemia, Colin Montgomery. I will be interviewing her Saturday. I love you guys so much. You know what I'm about to say? You know what I'm about to say? I love you so much. Go be loved today. Let somebody experience the love of God through you. Do something out your norm. Bless somebody unlikely. Pay for somebody's coffee, breakfast, or something. You don't know what kind of day someone's having. And then you see my t-shirt today? It says, live strong. Make a decision to live strong, to live strong. All righty, for sure. Traveling grace to your aunt. I'll traveling grace to you. I'm praying over your family. And I thank you, Lord God, that you are working on my behalf. I thank you, Lord God, that you are renewing everyone's mind, and we will be steadfast. I'll see you guys back here in the morning. We're getting ready to close Ruth out this week. And we're going to go into the book of Mark next. I'll talk to you guys later. Peace. Be so amazed. Won't he do it? Take me there again. I just call on Jesus, my friend.